If you would like a free newsletter on this or other subjects, just give us a call at Christian Answers. The phone number is area code 512-218-8022. That's 512-218-8022. Or you could email us at cdebater@aol.com. That's cdebater@aol.com.
Christian Answers. I'm Larry Wessels, Director of Christian Answers, and I want to thank you for being with us today. I'm joined in studio by our Director of Research, Steve Morrison. Great to have you here as
thank
usual,
you,
Steve. And we're going to be utilizing Steve's excellent research on early church history to present the case of the early Christian church in the great truths of the Christian faith that have followed them down to where we are now in the 21st century. And we're going to show from that the great truths of the Christian faith from the first century have held strong and true all the way through these millennia to our current day, and actually verify on just another level. There's so many levels that Christianity, the Bible, the truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ can be verified, whether from archaeology, biblical prophecy, manuscript evidence, but now here we have church history. That's just another way to verify that this Bible we have in our hand, Old Testament, New Testament, is true and will stand the test of time. Well, with that said, I want to just jump into this next show. We're into show number 5 now. If you missed the other 4 shows, go back and check them out. By the time you're seeing this, they may already be on the internet, or you can contact our ministry. We'll have DVD versions available, a variety of ways to get your hands on the other shows. Check out our websites also, BibleQuery.org, particularly HistoryCart.com, also gets particularly into this church history aspect. But by going to those sites, you can also find out how you can learn more about Christian Answers and getting your hands on the rest of this series in particular, although we have lots of stuff on lots of subjects. Anyway, we're talking about church history, brother. So why don't you just pick up where we left off, and we'll just go with that.
Okay. Well, as a recap from previous shows, what we're doing is I've read over between 4,100 and 4,200 pages of the writings that we have of early Christians prior to the Council of Nicaea in 325 A.D., and we say we have a consensus of writers that 4 or more writers agreed to something and some denied. And the numbers that you'll see on the slides show how many Christians writers affirmed each of these doctrines. Now, you might want to compare how your church or your organization matches up with what Christians taught. You know, whatever group you're part of, you might see some surprises. Now, of course, early Christians made some mistakes too. So the fact that they taught something, it doesn't guarantee that it's true. But if we believe that God guided his followers, then for the most part, what they believed would be okay. So we're going to look at the timeless truth of Jesus Christ. We're going to postpone his incarnation until a later show, but we're going to look at the timeless truths. All right. Well, they affirm that Jesus is the Son of God, all right, which, of course, is all over the New Testament, Matthew 16, 16, John 10, 36, etc. They also, more specifically, said that Jesus is the only begotten Son of God. And they also affirmed the deity of our Lord Jesus Christ. They would call Jesus God. And even all of the cults back then, the different Gnostics and everybody else, would affirm that Jesus was God. The Ebionites, they also would call Jesus God, but they would sort of say that was a title of honor. And we said the Sabellians, they believe that Jesus was God indistinct from the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and that later Arians believe that he was God, but he was a different different or dissimilar substance. So you kind of say, well, are they really believing in one God anymore? So they say Jesus is the Word of God. Jesus was in heaven from ages past. So long before he was born of Mary, he existed in heaven. Said all things were created through Christ, which many Christians affirm just because they quoted John 1:3. They love to quote the scriptures. Okay, here's one that some Christians haven't heard so much of, but Jesus was obedient to the Father, or he was subject to the Father. Okay, while on earth, and so while there is an equality of nature in the Trinity, there is a difference in role. Okay, Jesus was subject to the Father was not subject to Jesus. Okay, we should worship, praise, or glorify Jesus. Okay, many Jehovah's Witnesses will argue this one, but this is what the early church did. It was inseparable. The Father is in the Son, or the Son was in the Father, which, of course, we're taught from John 10:38. And Jesus is at the right hand of God, or the right hand of the Father. Stephen, as he was being stoned in Acts 7:56, he said he saw Jesus standing at the right hand of God the Father. Okay? So these are the timeless truths of Christ that all Christians today would agree on and Christians back then. They taught some other things that Christians today, many would agree, but not all Christians. They said that Jesus appeared on earth prior to his birth. So in the Old Testament, when you saw the three men appear to Abraham, they would say that one of those would be Jesus. Many Christians would agree with that. Some might not. Melchizedek, many Christians would say that was a type of Christ. Many early Christians would say, well, it was more than that. That was actually Jesus appearing to Abraham.
You're talking about the divine theophanies in
the Old Testament.
Such as when Gideon was hiding down in the water well, and the Lord appeared to him.
Yeah,
things of
the
that
nature. Yeah.
Or maybe even
the burning bush. They would say it's Jesus. It's all Jesus.
Or Joshua at the gates of Jericho.
The commander of the Lord's army. Yeah,
that's right.
And so some of those we would say today, they could be an angel. They could be just God, the triune God in general. Early church would generally say no. It was always Jesus. All right, so a little bit of disagreement there. But the other thing that most Christians would disagree with, though a few today would agree with, is it's that Christ appeared as an angel, or Christ can be called an angel. Some, like Justin Martyr, was the first to mention this, and he said that Jesus was man, Jesus was God, but then Jesus also appeared as an angel. And you say, well, angel can be messenger, but we would not necessarily agree with that.
And you got to be careful, because a lot of the cults, such as Jehovah's Witnesses, and even Ellen G. White of Seventh-day Adventism taught things like Jesus is Michael the Archangel.
Okay.
Jehovah's Witness doctrine calls for that, and they're actually, and that's how they can say Jesus was a God and not the God. They try to make him an angel,
right,
that was glorified, magnified by Jehovah God more than the real God, although Ellen G. White had a different twist on that than the Jehovah's Witnesses. But still, when you're talking about this early church writer, he wasn't going to that extent of claiming that Jesus was an angel like these modern-day cults would do.
Mm-hmm.
So just to clarify.
Yeah. So give us some examples. T3, for example, the deity of Jesus Christ. Ignatius, who was a disciple of John the Apostle, he wrote, "There is one physician," a physician is a doctor, of course, "who is possessed both of flesh and spirit, both made and not made, God existing in flesh, true life and death, both of Mary and of God," and then ... "even Jesus Christ our Lord." And this is the letter of Ignatius to the Ephesians, chapter 7, page 52. And just let you know, by the way, we have the letters of Ignatius in Greek, and there's also a Latin version, that they apparently added more to, and we're only quoting from the shorter, earlier Greek version. Okay, another one about Jesus being an angel, Justin Martyr, he wrote 135 to 165, he calls Christ King, Priest, God, Lord, Angel, Man, Captain, and Stone. This is in dialogue with Trypho, and Trypho was a Jew that he and Justin had a friendly discussion with, chapter 34, page 211. So he didn't really say too much about him being an angel, but he did throw it in there, and we would disagree with that. Back then, they disagreed. Ebionites called Jesus the Son of God. And they would say that Jesus was God, but only in a manner of speaking, as a title of honor. Theodotus the Tanner claimed that Jesus was a mere man, according to Caius, fragment 1, page 601. and Arians, a little before Nicaea, agreed that Jesus was both Son of God and God. However, they denied that Jesus was the same substance as the Father, but rather a similar, different, or lesser substance. Now, I have read on the internet and other places non-Christians claiming that the Council of Nicaea in 325 AD was to settle the issue, was Jesus God or not? And that is a patently false statement. The debate of the Council of Nicaea was between the Orthodox party that said Jesus was God and the same substance of the Father, and the Arians, who also affirmed that Jesus was God. So Nicaea was not about if Jesus was God. Nicaea was about how Jesus was God.
Mm-hmm. That's totally correct. And you know, all your cults and even Islamic apologists like Dr. Jamal Badawi and Nadir and some of these other guys out there, Shabir Ali, they make a big deal about the Council of Nicaea, 325. Mm-hmm. And they actually borrow a lot of arguments from Jehovah's Witnesses and other cult groups that are trying to make it look like the Council of Nicaea was where they invented this doctrine of the Trinity and all these new doctrines that the early church didn't affirm. Mm-hmm. But from what we're seeing here in this research,
it's patently false.
Exactly. So it's easy to see when you actually study early church history writings and what the early church taught and believed, and you know that information, that when you deal with some of these Muslim apologists, Jehovah's Witness argument, and they come on like they really know their stuff, like this is Council of Nicaea, 325, okay, Constantine, he started all, you know, they act like it's so true. And it kind of reminds me of what Hitler said about, or either it was his doctor of propaganda, Goebbels, you tell a lie long enough and loud enough, the people will believe you. And mm-hmm. and so they tell this lie like a drumbeat about the Council of Nicaea. And why does it work so well on people? It works so well on people because they're ignorant of church history. People have never studied early church history. They don't know what it says. And here comes along these Muslim apologists that sound like they really know what they're talking about. But as you just said, it's patently false. And all one has to do, and we've already mentioned this several times in this series, this stuff that you're referencing to is on the internet. It's in books you can order. We've already given the references, and you can contact us to get the references in case you miss it here.
Or go to our website.
Exactly. Yeah. Go to our websites. This is what you're going to get. You're just going to get a bunch of baloney that's presented to you as truth. And the only reason these arguments work on people is because the guys who are presenting this baloney to you are counting on the fact that you're ignorant of early church history.
And this is, in contrast, in our materials, this is why we give references for it. So you don't have to believe what we said about Justin Martyr or Clement or whoever. We give you the references. We're independent of us. You can go look it up for yourself.
Exactly. So anyway, that was a point that needed to be made, and it's been made. So go ahead.
Okay. Well, Jehovah's Witnesses, they will not ever call Jesus Almighty God, and they do not worship Jesus. Mormonism, a professor at BYU in the past has specifically taught we're not to have a relationship with Jesus, and Mormons do not believe that you ought to worship Jesus, just God the Father, the missionaries I've talked to and others. And just a small quibble we already discussed, that most Christians today don't believe that all of the appearances of God in the Old Testament were appearances of Jesus. They were very quick to see Jesus in lots of stuff. Because the early church was very Jesus-centric, very Jesus-focused, which is not a bad thing.
that's what makes them Christians. Yeah. They're worshiping Christ and centering their lives and theology on Jesus Christ,
right,
as your all in all, your Alpha and Omega, mm-hmm. beginning and end.
Yeah.
And what these other groups do is they take away from Christ to get off on other issues, which is basically what the devil's all about anyway. But anyway,
yeah.
Go ahead.
Yeah, but I was reading this one allegedly Christian book one time. It was written by a liberal Christian author, and it had to do with, well, a lot of stuff, and some people in psychology and things like that. And this was a Christian book, and I read through it, and I said, well, if Jesus Christ hadn't really come to earth, hadn't really died on the cross and rose from the dead for our sins, would it make any difference at all in this book? And the answer was no. And so he didn't really say anything wrong about Jesus. It's like Jesus was far from anything he was writing about, which, I mean, if it's a secular book, that's fine. But if this was a book in Christianity and there's nothing about the importance of centrality of Jesus, then, you know, if you're part of a group like that, you kind of wonder, are you really in the group God wants you to be in?
Exactly. And it comes down to that simple process of, if you're truly a Christian, then Christ is going to be the center of your life. He's the one you're worshiping. He's the one that your allegiance is to. He's the one that you repent of your sins for. You bow down and do what you do in your life because of him. If Christ is not the center, well, then anything else is possible, you see. But to be a real Christian, to be a true Christian, it's all about Jesus. Mm-hmm. Worshiping him and following his word through the power of the Holy Spirit and the electing grace of the loving Father in heaven. So anyway, go ahead.
Okay.
I could preach all day if you let me.
All right. Well, in an open public forum with a Muslim imam, I presented these truths about Christ and gave him a chance to respond. And as you expect, we had a lot more disagreement here than we had on some of the other topics in previous shows. He disagreed that Jesus was the Son of God. And of course, then he disagreed that he's the only begotten Son of God. The Quran specifically says, you know, that God is not a father and Jesus is not the Son of God. He disagreed on the deity of Jesus our Lord. They believe that Jesus was a prophet, but they don't generally follow his words that are preserved in the Bible. On Jesus as the Word of God, he disagreed. Now, this actually surprised me because the Quran says that Jesus is God's Word. It doesn't actually say whether he's a word or the word, but it says it is God's Word. And we discussed it, and he said, well, yeah, the Quran does say that, he said, but the meaning was very different. And he personally believed that Jesus being the Word of God in the Quran referred to his miraculous birth, you know, because Muslims do accept the virgin birth of Christ, and being a messenger of God. While, of course, Christians say being a Word of God means, you know, as a word comes from, you know, we say a word, we're not any less. So when Jesus was begotten of God the Father wasn't any less.
And it also cuts back to John 1:1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God,
right.
And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. That's John 1:1, going up to verse 14.
Right.
So you've got it right there from John, and of course there's many other references. But anyway,
yeah.
Go ahead.
Yeah. And by the way, the apostles are referred to in the Quran positively. So the word was the same, but he thought the meaning was too different to say that he would agree. All right. He disagreed that Jesus was in heaven from ages past.
Mm-hmm.
All things are created through Christ, so of course he disagreed with that one. We worship, praise, or glorify Jesus. He agreed with this. And he said, well, mostly, he said it's okay to praise and glorify Jesus, but not worship. Okay, now I was frankly very surprised when he said this. Now he said that likewise they will praise and glorify Muhammad, but not worship Muhammad. Okay, so notice here it says praise or, you know, worship, praise or glorify, not and glorify. So they would not worship Jesus. Many other Muslims, I feel, would probably give a different answer than he gave and say, well, you don't, you know, glorify is a pretty close word to worship. You don't glorify Jesus.
I've also noticed when it comes to Islam, dealing with a lot of Muslims, particularly ones that are really strong in their Islamic faith, that they do, it almost reminds me of Roman Catholics, staunch Roman Catholics who really venerate Mary.
Mm-hmm.
And they put Mary up there as the mother of God and the co-redemptrix and mm-hmm. all those other attributes that the Roman Catholic Church has bestowed on Mary and praying the rosary and everything. Well, just like Roman Catholics have almost this idolatry type worship of Mary, which they call veneration in their terminology, but to me, I don't see much difference between veneration and worship. It almost looks like idolatry, but in fact, from my perspective, it is. But they would disagree with me on that. But when you're dealing with Muslims, it almost seems to be a parallel with the Roman Catholic idea of the Virgin Mary. When they're talking about Muhammad, they are really putting him up high on a pedestal, right? With that same type of veneration. And it's almost like they pray to him.
They don't pray to Muhammad.
But
in the Hadith, when he cut his hair, or they might use his hair for like magic charms, or when he slept, they might put a sheet under him, and then his sweat would get on the sheet, and then they would use that sweat.
Well, you've got all these miracles and things associated with Muhammad that are in the Hadith. Mm-hmm. We've done shows on the Sahih Muslim and also the Al-Bukhari Hadith, mm-hmm. and we document all that. So if you want to check into that. But what I found when you're dealing with Muslims is to almost denigrate Muhammad is almost like denigrating the God they worship, which would be Allah in this case. Mm-hmm. It's something you just don't do. It's like, he's almost like a god himself, they wouldn't say that.
There are some sects of Islam that actually would say that Muhammad is divine and Ali is divine. These are not the mainstream Muslims, but the Muslims call them Gulat sects, mm-hmm. That believe
that. We've got a show covering that as well in mm-hmm. our repertoire, you might say, of different videos we've done. So if anyone wants to check on the videos we've done on Islam, but we can document all this for you from Islamic sources. Let's get back to what we're saying here.
Okay. The inseparable of the Son and the Father, or the Father and the Son, the Imam would disagree with that. The incarnation of the Word of Jesus. Now, incarnation means coming in the flesh. So, people say, well, how could man become a God? We don't believe man became a God. We believe God became a man, mm-hmm. and it was different. So man couldn't reach high enough or work hard enough or do anything enough to become God. But if God himself can come to earth. Now, of course, he disagreed with that. Mm-hmm. But when I talk with Muslims about this, I say, do you believe that God is almighty? And almost all the time, Muslims will say yes. And it says, so do you believe that God, if he wanted to, could even come to earth as a man? And so they kind of maybe might want to think about that a little bit, because if they don't believe that Jesus is the Son of God, you have to say, is it because you're saying God isn't powerful enough to do that? He's not really almighty. He can't do that. Or are you saying that God can do anything he wants, but he chose not to do that? Mm-hmm. Now, the first way doesn't make any sense if you're going to say God's almighty. Okay. Mm-hmm. Now, the second way, did God choose to do that or not to choose God? I mean, there are lots of things that God could have done, but he chose not to do. Mm-hmm. So we can talk about that. We can look at the evidence that he did and look at the reliability of the Bible and everything else. But that first way to say that God Almighty is too limited to mm-hmm. be incarnated as Jesus, just doesn't fly. Right. It's a self-contradictory thing. But anyway, the Muslims, I've talked to hundreds of Muslims, and universally, they will deny, the incarnation.
Well, their religion forces them into that perspective.
Right.
Because they simply don't accept the Word of God as we have it coming from the early church fathers.
Right. So anyway, what we've been doing in this series is showing that if you didn't have the Bible, let's say all the Bibles were to have disappeared or something, and all you knew about what Christianity taught was what early Christians wrote about, then we would actually know a lot. And we would actually be able to see all of these doctrines of Christ just from what four or more early Christians wrote and no one denied.
All right, I'm thinking just from the early church writings, you could recreate the vast majority of the Bible just from the quotations made of the Bible by these early church writers. They're always quoting the Bible. And just by taking their writings and looking at the verses they're quoting, you can almost reconstruct a vast majority of the text of the Bible without even having a Bible.
You could reconstruct 70% of the Gospels from just one writer alone, Tatian, and Tertullian and Cyprian and others just love to quote Scripture just right and left.
Exactly. So this in itself would refute big time a lot of these cults that are giving us all this stuff about Council of Nicaea and so forth. Mm. Anyway, go ahead.
All right. So when we keep mentioning the Council of Nicaea before then, we're not saying the Council of Nicaea is a bad thing. We think it's a good thing. But things really changed a lot in 325 when Christianity became the established religion. change in maybe some bad ways as well as good ways. But this is why we're focusing on the time period prior to that, when Christians were still oppressed, and to say this is the religion that they suffered for, they were persecuted for, and this is a religion that they died for. And this is the same religion, with a few small quibbles, that we believe today. And in the next section, we're going to look at what they said about Jesus coming on earth.
Okay. We're going to wrap it up for show number 5 in this continuing series on early church history. Please join us again for the next program in this series. I'm Larry Wessels with Christian Answers. Steve Morrison, our Director of Research for Christian Answers. If you have any questions, just call us or write us. We'll be glad to help you out. May the Lord bless you, and we'll see you next time.
Check out our websites, BibleQuery.org. This site answers 7,700 Bible questions. HistoryCart.com. This site reveals early church history and doctrine, proving Roman Catholicism is not historically or doctrinally viable. MuslimHope.com. This site is a classic refutation of Islam, a counterfeit religion created by Muhammad. Free newsletters are also available.